Doctor Who, a BBC series about the adventures of an alien who travels through time and space in a device called a TARDIS, which appears bigger on the inside than on the outside. It was a series shown on television, a device which also appears bigger on the inside than on the outside. While at Bredford, the boys were permitted use of television on Saturdays, which was when Douglas Adams first experienced Doctor Who. Inspired, the young Douglas wrote his own skit, Doctor Witch, a silly parody that featured things like Daleks powered by Rice Krispies. It was part of Douglas's awakening interest in science fiction, along with works like E.C. Eliot about adolescents that had been born in space, and The Adventures of Tiger Clinton were voraciously consumed. But Douglas had an actual hand with the comic book The Eagle. The young man sent in a small story that was published in the letters page of Eagle and Boys World, and was even paid for its inclusion. Science fiction left its mark on Douglas, and he would one day not only be paid to write it again, but he would do so for that series that he'd watched on Saturdays. He sent two spec scripts to legendary Doctor Who writer, and at the time script editor for the series, Robert Holmes. The first had included this idea of a B-arc, that of putting all the useless people in a society on one of three ships so that they can be sent away. The second was about the Doctor battling cricket-playing robots. Both were rejected as being too silly. This was an era of scarier and more mature stories for Doctor Who. But Holmes did say that he might commission Douglas if there was perhaps a sample of his work to base that on, but at the time he didn't have anything useful. That changed when Douglas had an approved script for a BBC radio series that I'll talk more about tomorrow. He sent this script into the Doctor Who office, and by now the series had been handed over to Graham Williams, who was impressed enough to meet with Douglas and commissioned a four-part story called The Pirate Planet. Douglas submitted the outline for the story well ahead of time, unusual since despite obeying linear time, Douglas often seemed unable to grasp the subtleties such as deadlines and the need to approach them from the correct direction. It was accepted, but it would need to be adapted into part of a larger arc, The Search for the Key to Time, which curiously paralleled the plot of Adam's story, The Cricket Men, that had been rejected, gathering together bits to form the infamous Wicket Key. The original concept for the Pirate Planet was that the Time Lords, the Doctor's people, had mined out this planet of a rare resource, so much so that it was now hollow, and to keep the locals from becoming annoyed at this setup, a device was created to drain their aggression. The engineer sent in to shut it all down winds up accidentally being trapped and absorbing all the aggression, and so plots revenge on his own people. It also included the idea of using time dams to allow people to stretch out their lives to try for immortality. Eventually the story was refined and the use of the planet to fly about was brought to the fore. The script required large open spaces, air cars, a mountaintop lair, lots of things that were at odds with Doctor Who's budgetary restrictions at the time, which usually meant corridors, lots of corridors. The head of drama actually wanted to reject the script, and Graham Williams himself was described as sinking into his chair as the story unfolded because of the obvious expense involved. But the script editor, Mr. Reed, and the director, Mr. Roberts, both thought it had potential, although it would take further work. Douglas' love of science fiction was all over this, with lots of ideas, from the planet that consumes other planets to mine them out, the time dams, the robot parrot, inertialess tunnels, as well as the fun, larger-than-life character of the captain, who is actually more complicated than he seemed with all of his blustering. The repeated motif of why conquer the universe is seen here as Douglas points out that it's not the captain's motive at all. As he says, you wouldn't know what to do with it, except shout at it. A clever idea and sharp dialogue played to Douglas's strengths. His background in writing skits helped in that regard, but that was also a weakness as his work suffered from structural deficiencies that would need to be worked out. Ultimately, The Pirate Planet was a success, and as the end of the season approached, when Mr. Reed announced his resignation, Graham Williams asked Douglas if he would take over as script editor. From the guy who needed his stuff patched up to the one now responsible for patching it up in just months. He took over with the end of The Armageddon Factor, which closed out The Key to Time, then began work on setting his own direction for the show, which would last for the entirety of the next season. But at the end of that season, he would move on. I'll get to that season on Thursday, but tomorrow we'll check in on that reason that he left, that other project, that little radio script. was about to launch Douglas Adams into the big time.